Amigos, una edición más de Auto 060 aquí en Cristina Radio Network. Tenemos un show con muchas entrevistas, muchas noticias muy interesantes. Y vamos a empezar con una de ellas, una entrevista con Jim Patterson, el editor asociado de Kiplinger Letter, para hablar sobre el estado en que está la industria automotriz y cómo es que vamos a llegar a casi 17 millones de autos vendidos acá en Estados Unidos tan pronto como el año próximo. Así que vamos, we're switching now to English to talk to Jim Patterson of the Kiplinger Letter. So now we're talking with Jim from the Kiplinger Letter. How are you, Jim? Thank you for having taking the time to talk with us.
Doing well, Javier. Thank you for having me.
Can you explain first for our audience who are not familiar with the publication, what does it do and why are you so interested in cars and all that?
Sure. We write a lot for small business owners, and we try to tell our readers about both government policy, what's going to be happening here in Washington, and we also try to tell our readers about how the economy is going to be doing so they can make their business plans accordingly. And cars are a big part of the economy, and a lot of our readers are in the car industry. They're auto dealers, or they run garages, or they're connected in some way to car sales. So they want to know, you know, what models are going to be selling well. They want to know how many cars are going to be sold this year or next year. They want to know about new car technologies. All these things affect a lot of their businesses.
Yeah, it seems that the auto industry goes, I mean, it doesn't seem, it's true. I mean, the auto industry goes hand by hand with the economy around the country. And for a while in the past year, 2 years, like while the economy wasn't doing that well, the auto industry was rebounding very strongly. And now we're getting to a point where we're going to get to the levels of 2008, I mean, almost 70 million cars, like by next year, right?
Right. We are getting close to getting back to the levels of car sales that we used to see before the recession. The recession that hit in 2008, 2009 really, really hurt the car industry. Car sales crashed back then. They were down more than 50% compared to before the recession. But since then, we've seen a steady recovery each year. And looking ahead to 2014, we're going to get back to a level above 16 million car sales for the first time since before the recession. Yeah, that goes back to 2007.
Yeah, it seems like that rebound in the industry, the auto industry, went faster than the rest of the economy. And I guess it's a different factors. One of them is that there's a lot of old cars down on the road, right?
Yeah, absolutely. The average car on the road today is getting pretty old. It's probably about 11 years old now. That's much higher than normal. A lot of people, you know, during the recession or right after the recession, they wanted to buy a new car, but they couldn't afford it, or maybe they just didn't feel confident about the economy. Maybe they were worried about whether they could hang on to their job. So a lot of people put off those sales for a long time, but, you know, cars are getting older now. They're starting to physically break down, and meanwhile, the economy's gotten a little bit better. People are a little more optimistic, so a lot of those sales that didn't happen a few years ago are happening now, so it's kind of a rebound effect.
Yeah, and the credit rates are still low, and the other thing that helps is, like, a lot of good offers from the cars. I mean, I don't think there's a bad car anymore in the market. I mean, there are cars that you might like, you don't like, but in general, I mean, the quality and all the technologies in cars are pretty good. And even though bigger cars with bigger engines are becoming more efficient, that's another reason, right?
Yeah, it's true. You hit the nail on the head. There's been a tremendous amount of physical improvement in new cars across the board, whether you're talking about, you know, little compact cars, whether you're talking about big pickup trucks, hybrids, you know, everything pretty much. They look better, they drive better. There's been a lot of new technologies added to cars, a lot more electronics. You know, you can have your smartphone integrated right into your car's audio system now. You know, you can be tweeting while you're driving if you do it through your car's stereo system. And the fuel efficiency is maybe the biggest change. There's been so much advance in engine technology, in other mechanical systems, in the way cars are designed to reduce air resistance. So we're seeing mileage now from pretty big cars that used to be not possible, except maybe for tiny little subcompact.
Yeah.
So, you can have a stylish-looking, roomy, feature-packed car that also gets really good gas mileage now, and people seem to be excited about that.
Yeah, GM is talking about the new Corvette as being an efficient car. I mean, who would have thought about that, right?
Yeah, right. Who would have thought that 10 or 20 years ago? I heard that the new Corvette, I don't think it's on sale yet, but it's going to be hitting dealers very soon. The new Corvette's going to be rated at 29 miles per gallon by the EPA, and I think GM actually says that if you put the car in its efficiency mode, it can hit 30 miles per gallon. And that car has a big V8 engine. It's going to have 450 horsepower. It's going to be extremely fast, but it's getting the sort of mileage that maybe 10 years ago we would have been talking about for a little compact economy car.
Yeah, I'm actually going to go and drive it pretty soon in California.
Oh, really?
But I don't think they're going to make that mileage.
No, if you drive it the fun way, you probably won't.
Exactly. Jim, another question about the new trends here in the States. Diesels are, I don't know if you can call it a comeback, because they were never very big for passenger cars. But now there's a lot of offers. I mean, Chevrolet also has the Cruze with a diesel engine. Jeep is coming out with a Grand Cherokee with a diesel engine, and there's a lot. So you think, I mean, the Germans always been like Volkswagen, Audi, all that group. But do you think the consumers are ready for make that change, even though diesel is more expensive in most of the states?
Right. It does seem like there's more consumer awareness and more interest in diesel now than we've seen in a long time. Yeah. As you said, for a very long time, the German car companies, especially Volkswagen, really dominated diesel. They kind of had a monopoly on the market. No one else really seemed to want to sell a diesel car. But now we're seeing a whole lot more brands branching out. As you said, the new Cruze, which I think has 46 miles per gallon on the highway, you know, which is really, really good. And as you said, the Jeep Grand Cherokee, Mazda's going to be selling diesels in multiple models. And meanwhile, Audi and Volkswagen are going to be expanding their diesel offerings. It's not going to just be in, you know, the Golf or the Jetta anymore. It's going to be across the lineup. BMW is coming with more diesels. Mercedes is coming with more diesels. So clearly these car companies have done the market research, have talked to consumers, have run the numbers, and have decided that, yes, you know, there's a business case to be made here. I really think that diesels are really geared toward, you know, drivers who are, you know, we would call enthusiasts. They value handling and pickup, and they still care about good mileage. Maybe they're not so interested in a hybrid, which gets very good mileage but might be kind of slow. There's a lot of performance-oriented diesels out there where you get a good combination of, you know, speed and fuel efficiency. So I think it kind of hits a sweet spot for those folks.
Yeah. Yeah, we're talking with Jim Patterson, Associate Editor of the Kiplinger Letter. Jim, another thing, do you have any recommendations about, I mean, there's a lot of offering also between hybrids and electric cars. Are they still worth it, in your opinion, to pick them up, even like, for example, a gasoline engine car or a diesel engine car?
Right. You know, it's a tough call if you're talking about the value proposition, because you're going to pay a premium for a hybrid, and you're going to have to really do the math and think, will I really save enough money on gas to make this worth it? You know, you're probably going to spend a few $1,000s more for a hybrid versus a regular, you know, conventional gasoline-powered car. And, you know, a lot of people probably would take a very long time to make up that cost in the fuel savings down the road. So it's a tough calculation, but a lot of people really value fuel economy, even if it's not just for dollars and cents to save money. A lot of people care about the environmental aspect of it. And hybrids are proving to be fairly popular sellers, and certainly the Toyota Prius, which everyone knows about, always is up high on the list of best-selling cars month after month. You know, electric cars, it's a much tougher sell because the technology is not nearly as mature yet. You know, they're very expensive. Most of the electric cars on the market now can only go maybe 80 miles to 100 miles before you have to recharge them. They take a long time to recharge. So they're just, it's hard to make the case that they're practical replacements for cars with either, you know, a gasoline engine or a hybrid engine or a diesel engine, which are easy to fuel up. But we're starting to see baby steps for electric cars. A lot more manufacturers are working on them. They're trying to figure out how to make the batteries hold more energy so the cars can go farther. They're trying to make the cars lighter for the same reason so the cars can go farther on a charge. They're trying to figure out how to make them a little less expensive. So I think that's a prospect for several years down the road before electric cars really break out and become a mainstream sort of option.
Yeah, it was very curious last week when the North American Car and Truck of the Year Award announced its long list of candidates. There were no hybrids, but there were a few electric. So, I mean, I guess it's a trend that is going to, as you say, it's going to take a little while, but it's happening, right?
It is happening, and there's a lot of excitement around some electric cars. I've certainly read a lot of great reviews of Tesla's new electric sedan, which I haven't gotten to drive one yet, but I certainly see them on the streets here in D.C. It's a great looking car.
Yeah, the Model S is amazing.
The review I've read says that it drives really well. It's very expensive, certainly, so it's really geared toward the luxury end of the market, people especially who value the technology. But there's a lot of exciting things going on. A lot of, as I said, baby steps are being taken right now by manufacturers, and I think that's going to pay off in the long run.
Well, we're running out of time, Jim. Unfortunately, we can't be talking for a long, long time. Jim Patterson, associate editor of the Kipling Letter. Anywhere that people can find out about more about your publication and how they can subscribe?
Yeah, absolutely. Go to kiplinger.com. You'll see a ton of our content there that we publish both from our newsletter as well as our personal finance magazine and other features that are just dedicated to the website. If you like what you see there, there's easy links to either call us to subscribe, or you can just sign up right online and get started right away.
Well, thank you very much. And one more last question, since you're based in Washington, D.C., what do you make of the purchase of Jeff Bezos of the Washington Post? Maybe he can put like a betrayer kind of thing for cars.
I hope he can do something, because obviously the newspaper industry is struggling to find a successful business model in this age of the internet. So you know, he's been a great entrepreneur in the past. He's shown he can make businesses really profitable, and it'll be interesting to see what he can do with the Post. But everybody's still kind of in shock down here.
Yeah, I saw a funny post on Facebook, someone saying that Jeff Bezos, based on your recent purchase, you can also be interested in the LA Times, your Times.
Yeah, right. He's probably got a lot of things to do on the shopping list now.
Okay, thank you very much, Jim, for your time, and I hope to talk to you soon again.
All right, my pleasure, Javier. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.